Yo, this is Deontay the Bronze Bummer Wilder, heavyweight champion of the world, and you're watching Real Fans Real Talk.
Face facts, what up?
RealFansRealTalk.com, where Arthur Thomas, Trip Young, and intern Tom, for the white and black fans, Asia to Manhattan. I get all my facts from my bro, Mark the Stats Man. If you're not tuned in, I recommend a CAT scan. And if your brain checks out, then you deserve a backhand. Sports, gossip, all the hot topics. RealFansRealTalk.com got it. They got the hottest bloggers.
Did Jeremy Lin hurt?
We'll log onto the site and you can hear it from them first. I'm talking about the latest. I'm talking about the greatest. Go check out the archives. Even tell a neighbor. Tell a Bobby sent ya. From spring to winter. Tuning in should be the only thing on your agenda. Certified cosign. You know what I'm about, son. RealFansRealTalk.com. I'm out. One. Real fans. Real talk. Real fans. Real talk. RealFansRealTalk.com. RealFansRealTalk.com. Real fans. Real talk. Real fans. Real talk. RealFansRealTalk.com. RealFansRealTalk.com.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to another live episode of Real Fans Real Talk. I'm Mark the Statman Skevich. We got a great show lined up for you tonight. A packed house in the studio. We got a lot of special guests. We got some Golden Gloves fighters. We got an interview with myself and John Starks. We got a little piece of it. It's a very long interview. A little trailer for you guys. I know those of you following us on social media saw some of the clips of it. We're going to play some of it for you tonight. We got some Golden Gloves fighters, including the one that I stepped in the ring with, who ended up being the Golden Gloves champion this year, Conja Nathan, and a lot of interesting stuff going on tonight's episode. We got a lot to talk about, but before we get into the sports topics, Trip Young will be here later on. Ladybug will be here. The usual suspects are in the building, but I want to remind some of you guys of the fight that I had with our first guest a couple of months back when the Golden Gloves tournament started, and he kind of made me look a little bit bad, but I didn't hold it against him. And he ended up getting the victory, but we're going to do a little flashback. It is Thursday, so a little bit of a throwback Thursday for you guys out there. We're going to play the fight with myself and Conja Nathan, and then he'll be here live in studio when we come back.
Mike, I'm up there.
You cut it.
All right, we are back here live on Real Fans, Real Talk. And talk about sportsmanship there, ladies and gentlemen. Even though he beat me, no grudges held. The one and only Conja Nathan in the building. Welcome to the program.
Thanks for having me.
All right, now, do you remember that fight at all, or?
Yes, I do.
What was your take on it? Like, what did you think when you see somebody much larger than you and you're stepping into the ring with him? Obviously, you're used to fighting bigger fighters, but.
Actually, I go into every fight the same. You know, it's, don't underestimate anybody. I didn't know nothing about you, so it's kind of like, I take it like you can beat me, so I went in there with that mindset. Mm-hmm. So
that's the right way to do it. You definitely don't want to underestimate somebody. You see that all the time in sports. Even when you are familiar with somebody, you see a team that's a heavy underdog, and they end up pulling out the victory. You've had a lot of experience, though. That was actually my first amateur fight, yes. Period. I wasn't even really familiar with the rules because, you know, traditional boxing, you know, you have to be knocked down before there's any counting. So I'm like, what's going on here? Why is the ref counting? Like, and then, you know, sure enough, he felt for whatever reason to end the fight. My trainer told me afterwards, you got to put your hands up when he says eight, before he says eight, so he knows that you're good. And I wasn't familiar with it, but you were obviously clearly ahead in the lead. I caught you with a couple punches. I don't know if you remember feeling them or not or whatever, but going forward, what was it like after getting that victory? The confidence builder, or moving on into the tournament, or?
Yeah, it was actually it made me work harder because, you know, like I said, everybody else in there, I gotta go in there like they can beat me also. So it's kind of like I had to keep training, and you know.
What did you think of me as a fighter in comparison with people that you've sparred with or trained with, or for somebody having their first fight?
You actually did good for your first fight, but me being the more experienced fighter, I did what I had to do. So it's kind of like, you know, because of the level that I'm on, it just, you know, makes it look different. It makes me look different compared to other fighters.
And when did you start boxing?
I started boxing at February 10th, 2012.
Okay, so about 4 years ago. Yeah. And when was your first amateur fight?
My first amateur fight was April 20th or 19th of 2013.
Okay. So approximately 3 years later, you still enter the novice division. Did you feel like you weren't ready for the open yet, or?
Well, it goes by fights, and I didn't have enough fights to be considered open class.
Oh, so they wouldn't even let you even if you wanted to?
Well, if I wanted to, they would have let me, but, you know, it's with the fights that I have, why not, you know, go in my class still, so.
Make it easier to get the gold around your neck, which you eventually ended up doing. Now, going into the finals, you have the Barclays Center, big stage, I mean, playing in, you know, a lot of these amateur fights are just in, you know, little, you know, boxing gyms or little halls and stuff like that, capacity of a couple of hundred people. Now you've got, you know, the Barclays Center where you could fit, you know, close to 20,000 people or around 20,000 people. Obviously, it didn't pack the house. It was only the Golden Gloves.
Yes.
But you did have over 1,000 in the building, and just being in, you know, in a stage like that, what was that like going into the fight?
It was overwhelming. I didn't know how to take it in. It was my first time being there. I fought so hard to get there. So when I got there, it was just like, it took the breath out of me.
Now, the, you know, Real Fans, Real Talk crew was in the building that day. And, you know, we were there, you know, to check out the festivities. We had our little press thing going on, taking some photos and all that. And I mentioned that the guy who beat me is in the finals, and some of the other people I was with is like, oh, so you're over there rooting for him to lose, and I'm like, no, it's the exact opposite. I want him to win so that when, you know, I justify losing my first fight to the guy who won it all, and, you know, you made him look bad too, you know. You actually knocked him on the ground. You didn't knock me on the ground. You knocked him on his butt, and, you know, he looked, you know, strong, like more cut than I was. Like, you know, maybe even taller too. He looked more like a machine too. So everyone, one of my co-hosts, Sean Fontaine in the Bronx TV station, he was saying, "Oh, that guy's, you know, you like that you're gonna lose." Yeah. I was like, "No, trust me, he's gonna win." Like, don't you know, like you said, don't underestimate somebody. I mean, I saw how elusive you were, you know, and usually when I spar, I kind of dominate. So it wasn't something that, you know, I expected to like lose, you know, look bad like that. And, you know, I didn't really post all the sparring and stuff like that, but, you know, I'm posting my first fight and I'm like, this is what I have to show all my friends. Like, people are thinking like, oh, look at him. Like, he didn't belong in there. Like, you know, so, but, you know, you did the same thing pretty much to him. I mean, he got a lot more shots in. He went the full three rounds. The ref didn't stop the fight. You did knock him down. What was it like, you know, that fight after you got the knockdown? Were you confident in the third round after it was all said and done that you were going to take home the gold?
Yes. It was actually before the third round, in the middle of my of the rest. Mm-hmm. It was a speech given to me, and it kind of gave me, like, new energy, new breath. So that's when I came out, and shortly after, I got the knockdown.
Now, what was the speech that you got?
All right, so leading up to this fight, I was doing a lot of sprints in the hallway. So I was actually tired, and my trainer, Owen Radway, pushed me, and he was like, you know, you only got 8 minutes, and on six out of those 8 minutes, you're fighting, two of them is rest. So during the fight, the last round, he was like, yo, you remember the sprints? And I said, yeah, and then that's when my new energy came and went and did what I had to do.
Now, what has training been like over the years?
Hard.
Like, do you have a specific routine? Like, you know, heavy bag, speed bag, like how many rounds or anything like that? Or is everything just kind of changing?
Everything changes.
Do you go Rocky style and go out into the middle of nowhere and, you know, like...
Well, bag work is 12 rounds, so, you know, nothing short of 12, so.
Now, so what's next? Are you looking to go pro, or are you looking to fight next year in the open, or what's next?
That's the question that everybody asks me after the finals, but I think we're definitely going to go to do open class, you know, and then we'll talk after that.
All right. Do we have some of that footage ready yet? All right. So we're waiting on that footage. We actually have one of our blog writers we want to get, because we got a lot of guests here on the program. So we want to get one of our blog writers here on the show, too. He's not here yet either. So. All right, so let's talk NBA. You know, we have the playoffs coming around. Are you a fan of NBA? Like, who's your team?
Cleveland, 100%.
Okay, so it's kind of like Trip Young is still in the building here. I got a Cleveland Cavaliers, LeBron James fan. So
yeah, LeBron
you
fan.
You just follow him wherever he goes? Is that how it works?
That's exactly how it works.
What do you think their chances are of you know, coming out of the East, and also
me being confident in LeBron James, they're gonna win it. You know,
they're gonna win it all.
Yeah,
they're
of course.
Come out of the East.
They're definitely gonna come out the East.
Well, another biased Cleveland Cavaliers fan. So, what's your other sports teams?
The Baltimore Ravens.
This is exactly like Trip Young. What are the chances that you're a Baltimore Ravens fan in New York and a Cleveland Cavaliers fan? Trip Young, is this your little brother, or did you send and Yankees for baseball?
Well, I'm not really a baseball fan, but okay.
All right. And hockey supporting the Rangers, or
yeah.
All right, so we're gonna have we're gonna have some. Well, Well, so what do you think as far as we're going to switch back to boxing for a little bit because we don't have any of the videos up. We don't have our blog writer up and things are a little bit all over the place on tonight's live episode. But what do you think as far as Mayweather retiring without breaking the record? Do you think he's going to come back? Do you think that, you know, he's definitely going to stay retired? And what do you think as far as him being retired?
Honestly, I can't call it because I'm not in Mayweather's camp. But, I mean, there's no reason for him to. He did what he had to do. He made a statement already. His name is out there. That's it.
And what do you think as far as the Conor McGregor switching over to UFC? What do you think as far as the recent drama with him? People thought he was retired and he kind of just said he's not really retired, but he just wants to focus on training and not focus so much on the promoting side.
I can't speak on that situation. So,
but do you admire that, I guess, as a fighter that, you know, it's not all about the, you know, the publicity and stuff. Yeah. It's more about the fighting. Okay. All right. So, okay, so we have another video. We have one of the videos ready. We did a charity event this past weekend for Family on Three. We had John Starks, as I mentioned, at the top of the program, and we also had Power 105's M Easy. My co-host Trip Young had the pleasure of chopping it up with him, and we're going to play that for you. And when we come back, we'll have more on Real Fans, Real Talk.
What's going on, Trip Young? We out here at the Family on Three charity event at Springfield High School. And y'all see who I'm with right now, M-Easy, Power 105.1. Now, you are the producer on The Breakfast Club.
No. I don't want to take that credit. I'm not the producer. I'm one of the guys that run the show in the background.
Okay. He runs the show.
There's
now.
There's a lot of people in the behind the scenes that you don't ever see. I'm just one of those guys. I don't want to take too much credit.
All right, now, how is it on The Breakfast Club? Because it's probably the best morning radio show in the country, but you got one of the biggest characters in Charlamagne Tha God. How is it working with Charlamagne every day?
It's indescribable. You can't describe that guy, Charlamagne. He's got a different type of sense of humor. But The Breakfast Club as a collective is an amazing group of three with Envy and Angela Yee. Their work ethic and their drive is something that it's nice to see as a young guy doing what they're doing or trying to be where they're at.
And you guys also have some of the most interesting guests from all facets of the industry. Recently, you guys had Dick Gregory on the show, dropping a whole lot of knowledge. What was that one like?
I mean, another interesting situation is interesting fellow in Dick Gregory. The Breakfast Club, like you said, they're a nationally syndicated morning show. They reach millions and millions of people. So when anybody asks to come up, The Breakfast Club could have that reach. You know, presidential candidate. He came up and talked to Charlamagne in The Breakfast Club.
Bernie Sanders?
Bernie Sanders, yeah. He's been up to The Breakfast Club. So their reach is long, man.
Okay. And I see you guys have Hillary coming on to the show. Is it this Monday she's supposed to come on?
Absolutely, yeah. That's crazy. I was there when she came in. That's crazy.
So now the Sunday sit down?
Absolutely. I do have a weekend show, one of the top rated weekend shows in New York City, actually. Saturday and Sunday afternoons, the Sunday sit down has been doing very well, actually.
Okay. Now, how long have you actually been in radio?
In radio behind the scenes for almost seven, eight years now. On air for about three, four.
Now, a lot of times, once you're in radio, you start to make that transition into television. Is that something that you're looking into doing?
Oh, yeah. I'm looking for a TV check. I just started acting in a web series, Blue City. You can catch it on YouTube. That's cool. I mean, I'm just trying to dibble and dabble and make as much money as I still can.
Now, who are you playing in the web series, Blue City?
His name is Remedy. He's a music producer. And the last episode, I got shot. You got to go check it out, see if I die or not. I'm taking bullets out here.
It's real. Definitely getting your act on. Anytime you take a shot on camera, that's a great thing. Are you trying to do any movies?
I mean, if I get asked to, I would love to. I mean, I'm still relatively new and fresh, so I don't think I would say no to a role, but unless I'm kissing men, you know, I ain't doing all that, but, you know. I'd love to do acting, yeah.
I got you. All right, now, we are out here at the Anthony Mason Jr.'s Family on Three charity event. How did you wind up linking up with Anthony Mason Jr. and the whole Family on Three?
Now.
Anthony Mason Jr. came in and kicked it with me on the Sunday sit down. I interviewed him. He talked about a lot of the things he was doing. And when he brought this thing up, I was like, I'd love to be a part of it. John Starks, who's also here, he came down and interviewed with me as well. So when they were talking about this, I wanted to be a part of it. I like talking to the kids and being part of the community and being someone that's the kids could look up to.
All right, and I know you're a busy man, so we're not going to keep you too long, but please tell the folks at home where they can reach you at and how they can follow you in both the Sunday Sit Down and the Breakfast Club.
Breakfast Club, Power 105.1, you know the Breakfast Club already. My Instagram is IAMEZ, that's IAMEMEZ. YouTube, same deal. Facebook, same deal. It's easy to find. IAMEMEZ.
All right, Trip Young, Real Fans, Real Talk. We out here, family, on 3. M Easy. Thank you for coming on the program.
RealFansRealTalk.com. Where Arthur Diamond, Trip Young, and intern Tom. For the white and black fans, Asia to Manhattan. I'll get on my...
All right, we are back live on Real Fans, Real Talk. Mark the Statman, Skevich, alongside Golden Gloves, Wither, Conja, Nathan, and the Heavyweight Novice Division, and Golden Gloves finalist, Justin Biggs. And, of course, the one and only Ladybug, because social media is very impatient and they want their Ladybug. So she's in the building as well. Me, personally, the Rangers are giving me gray hairs right now during this live broadcast. So excuse me if I'm not on my A game. They're currently down 3-0 right now.
He's checking his phone.
We had a fan mail question. John from Bensonhurst wrote in, Statman, what do you think about the Rangers going behind 2-1 at home, and now it's looking like it might be 3-1? I am very worried, but once again, the social media is going crazy for Ladybug. So, Ladybug, welcome back to the program. Always a pleasure.
Thank you so much. How are you this week? Good.
I'm doing good, except for the Rangers giving me grades.
I know, guys. He's been on his phone during the... He's like, okay, check in. But, you know, you hold it down, Statman. That's why they call him the Statman. It's all right.
There you go.
But I hope you guys are having a good week. It's your favorite Ladybug telling you the rumor mill. So, just to get it started, first and foremost, Conor McGregor came out with this whole controversy. He came out on Twitter saying that he decides to retire young. So it caused a whole uproar. Like, what is going on? What does he mean? Even, you know, one of the coaches were like, well, you know, it was a good run. So people are going crazy on social media. Like, is he going to retire? Like, how do you retire on social media? Like, it was a whole bunch of backlash. And basically, he went later on this week and posted saying, I am not retired. And basically, his argument is that he needs to focus more on fighting and less on promoting. And basically, he blamed his loss against Diaz on him promoting more than he was training. So, you know, we don't know how true that is. And, you know, that's the story he's going to take and run with it. But basically, he's saying that, you know, his team is putting all this money in promotions and he's not spending time training because he's getting paid to fight and not paid to promote. Just rambling on and on and on in social media. But basically, he's saying that he's not trying to commit to any type of promotional activities. He wants to seclude himself, focus on training, and go in, you know, raging at the next fight. Mm. So, any opinions on that? Do you feel like promotion can really stop or hinder a
fighter? Well, I've seen a few cases where that happened. One instance when Zab Judah fought Carlos Baldomir, they said they had him doing a lot of press conferences and things like that. But in actuality, I think that did play a part of him losing in ideas. But overall, I think the true issue here is that the money. You know, they were saying that boxers, the top fighters, will make 60% of the total venue. Mm-hmm. But Conor McGregor only is making 20%. Mm-hmm. But he's one of the top UFC fighters. And the UFC being ran by one person, you know, which is Dana White, makes it unfair. You know, like NBA has a governing body and things like that. But for UFC, it's really a monopoly. And I think that's what it's about, money.
Okay. Any input? No? All righty, Statman.
I mean, we touched on it a little bit before the break. Yeah. I mean, I do think that that's probably also what happened with Ronda Rousey. She's so busy doing movies. She's busy doing the promotions. for UFC, going on this talk show, that talk show, a lot of traveling, not training as much as she used to, so she took the loss. With him, I kind of predicted it before with Nate Diaz. It's, you know, trying to match weight and, you know, going. He's going up against the bigger fighter, plus the fights that he had before that, he lost to submission, and Nate Diaz was the submission expert, so I kind of figured it might, you know, go that way. I mean, Conor McGregor, you know, he beat Ronda Rousey's record with a quick knockout, and that's what really elevated his fame. He wasn't that famous a couple of years ago, so he was, you know, at the top for a few fights, and, you know, his comments out there, and really for promotions, and he even said it, you know, this is, you know, you're welcome, because this is more promotion that you need. Like, you know, you don't necessarily need to go to these press conferences that most people aren't necessarily, you know, watching every now and then. If you're saying something crazy, then they'll put it out there on ESPN. Conor McGregor said this or said that. He could do that on Twitter. He doesn't necessarily need to do that. And that's exactly what he did. Everyone thought he retired. And, you know, I saw something where the people thought he was going to the WWE. And, you know, the next thing you know, he announces that he's not retired and he is fighting in the rematch. So, you know, that's enough of a promotion as it is. I don't think you need that much promoting for somebody like that. You need promoting for people that aren't as well known.
Yeah, so. and that's basically what he said also. You know, he didn't say it as nice, but he definitely, you know, protested that, you know, he leaves that for people who need it. So that's his thing. I'm waiting to see what happens next, because something that comes out his mouth always ends up on social media. So I'm looking forward to that. Next up, Michael Strahan is definitely under a little bit of quote-unquote beef against Kelly Ripa. He announced on Tuesday he is leaving Live and going to Good Morning America. And I don't know if you guys really kept up. Back in the day, it used to be Live with Regis and Kelly, with Regis Philbin and Kelly Ripa. And the issue with that is basically he left without any prior notice, like Michael Strahan. He just went and, you know, after the show was done, he said, you know what? This is not for me. I'm on to the next one. And basically, you know, Kelly Ripa wasn't on the show for the past 2 days. They had guest hosts and things like that. And, you know, people are speculating she's just feeling really hurt for the fact that this is the second time this is happening to her. And she, you know, she's been a face on TV for years. Even before, you know, Live, she was on soap operas and things like that. So I think, you know, for it happening again in the public eye, you know, she's just taking it really hard. But, you know, Michael Strahan, he definitely came and, you know, on Good Morning America, he, you know, professed his love. He said thank you to the whole team, the executive producers. Everybody's there. Is no, you know, it's no tough love. There's no issues. You know, I guess he felt that he just needed to move on, but he knew that his foundation was with them. So, you know, he tried to leave it off on a good note, but social media likes to switch it up all the time, you know. It's always, they like the drama. Social media likes the drama. And, you know, he just came from football and got on TV, but his, you know, the popularity just grown with him. He's a household name. He's fun-loving. Everybody, you know, likes when he makes a fool out of himself. But it's all in good fun, all in good TV. Some people are looking for the drama to be another spinoff, but we don't know what's going to happen. You know, television always looks for something. So they just need to have me. That's it. It's all right.
There you go.
That's it.
She's coming for your job, Strahan. You might think you're comfortable now, but Ladybug will take your job. And, you know, then there'll be some other beef going on.
No, it's all love.
I mean, he says there's all love on his end. I'm not sure if it's reciprocated on the other side of it, you know, but I mean, you don't know what really went on behind the scenes for that to happen, for him to leave, but I'm sure, you know, that there was something that's not being said that, you know, led him to decide to go and jump ship.
Yeah, I think, like I said, for it to be the second time that it happened to her, she didn't know how to really, you know, take it. And not only how to take it, but then how to go the next morning on live TV and, you know, not see your co-host there for years.
I wonder what that's like. I have a miniature version of Trip Young here. He's got, you know, he's a Ravens fan and a Cavs fan, but, you know, we don't have that chemistry.
But, yeah, so I just hope she takes it well. She always bounces back and always, you know, hope the best for everyone. You know, on another note, on a more serious note, and it probably was touched on earlier, I just got to send my condolences to Chyna from WWF. I'm sorry. You know, it's WWE now. I know it. I stand corrected. But when she was in there, it was WWF. I was always in Madison Square Garden with my family, screaming my head off. Wow. And the fact to hear that this morning is very devastating. Also to Prince, my mom called me crying on the phone from her job. You know, when an artist impacts your life like that, it's something that you can't even describe. Because she never met that man. She never sat down with him. She never, you know, she doesn't know him personally. But for, you know, that entertainer to make an impact on her life, for her to call me and crying like he's a family member. Because I'm like, what's going on, Mom? She's like, you heard Prince die. I was like, what? And then it hits me because even in this day and age, you don't find entertainers that span generations anymore. You know, they're here for the, you know, quick come in, quick come out, and then it's the next one. So to find, you know, artists that can span generations, even to, you know, me and my younger sisters grown up listening to it, you know, it's really heartbreaking. And I don't know him personally, but it's just really, really heartbreaking. Breaking the hair, so you know, condolences to everybody that passed. It's crazy.
Absolutely.
It's a lot. It's sad. Yeah. It's a lot.
Yeah, I mean, music touches you emotionally, so I mean, I could see the bond with that with certain artists. And I mean, me personally, I don't know when celebrities pass, it's like, oh, that's a shame. That's about it.
Yeah.
It
says,
I'm like, but they never did nothing for me, like, you know,
personally.
But I get it, you know, how other people could feel attached to them, you know, especially if that's one of your favorites or, you know, there's a song that you, you know, particularly related to. So.
And it's just, it's a whole, it was just a really sad time. But that Chyna, you know, even, like, that was just somebody that me personally looked up to. Like, you know, yeah, she was curvaceous and she flaunted herself, but she knew how to kick butt. And it was like, yeah, I look good, but I don't know.
In dominant fashion.
Yeah, but I'll powerbomb you, like, if I have to.
That's why she stopped fighting the women and had to fight the men, because she
there was no competition,
I know it's fixed and everything, but.
Yeah, so it was something that even now that, you know, seeing these younger girls, and you don't see, you know, they're more divas now. They're divas, like these WWE, they're divas. And yeah, they were divas before, but, you know, the little hair pulling and all that, it wasn't nothing compared to what Chyna did before.
Like, power bombing people.
Yeah, like, come on. But she still had her long hair and her leather bustier and did what she had to do. So it was definitely, you know, heartbreaking. I felt it today.
The memes out there with Eddie Guerrero, like, welcome to heaven, mamacita, and all those other ones, like, you know. I mean, I found out about it last night, and you know, it's one of those things. Oh, that's a shame, you know. I mean, and you know, she had her difficulties. She was on celebrity rehab. She, you know, posed for Playboy, then did porno, then celebrity rehab. So you know, she you know, went through a little bit of a rough patch. But no cause of death on either of the celebrities you mentioned. The, you know, keeping it hush hush. Prince passed away in an elevator. And, you know, her, they just said she went peacefully, like, whatever that means.
You know, I think, especially, you know, with Chyna, and then not only, just both of them, I feel like they were in the public eye for so long. And, yeah, they had two different, you know, lanes, but when you step back from the public eye, I feel like they think of it more of a positive thing. Like, I don't want the cameras all over me. I don't want things like that 24/7. Let me step out of the light. But you don't know what's going on in their personal life. When you have those paparazzi and those cameras, you would kind of peer in, but you don't know what's really happening. So they could have been still dealing with certain things that they didn't want anybody to know, and they didn't want to, you know, they didn't feel comfortable because you have all these people, like, that you're not comfortable around. Right. They're not family. They're not friends. Yeah, they're your team. And yeah, they know you for a long time. But there's still certain issues you don't feel comfortable talking to certain people about. And they hold it in and hold it in. And you don't know what their vices are either. So, you know, however that they went, I just hope that, you know, people just respect it. And, you know, their legacy is going to live on regardless.
Absolutely.
So I just hope, you know, people just respect that. Because not only that, you know, social media tried to screw it up. They put a picture of Khloe Kardashian saying, you know, rest in peace. And I'm like, don't do things like that. You obviously know that's not her. Yeah, you joke around. You know, people want to look similar and they say they have similar. But, you know, just don't be disrespectful. Be mindful of what you do. I know people's freedom of speech and all that. I understand that. I'm one of those. I can do whatever I want on my page. I'm one of those too. But, you know, me personally, I have more consideration for that. So that's that.
Sometimes you do a little too much on your page, apparently, but we're not going to get into that.
You see, Stat? Come on, Stat, man. Come take on. Some follow shots. Me Trip on Young's, social media.
Trip Young's not here. I got to take the shots for two of us now.
You see, that's the real MVP, taking shots. But
Justin's here. We didn't really touch on your career yet. I know you're jumping in the conversation with some of the other topics, but tell us about your background in boxing.
It was never a time I wasn't around boxing. I have an older brother who's 10 years older than me. And my father would take me to the gym in a stroller, and I'd watch him. And even when I was little, everywhere I went, you know, he taught me and make me shadow box in front of people. And so I grew up in it. You know, my brother was very successful and went on to winning many championships. I got started when I was around 14 years old. But me fighting, it was a very slow process because of the fact of when I was about 12 years old, my dad, he had cancer and he got sick. And so his whole life he was going through the pain but not really telling me. But he lived for 13 years, but it was very on and off for me. When I was 19, I left and I went to New York City, came here and started fighting. I was in Florida at the time. And then things started to really take off for me. But at the age of about 23, he got sick again, and he ended up passing away last April. You know, when he passed away, he told me basically that if he had a way for him to go on and do great things, he would have took it, because nothing is more painful than getting old, you know, and living with regrets that I could have did this, I could have did that. At that moment, I just went on fighting, trying to make the Olympics. They chose to give the opportunity to other people, but I thought I had won the fight. But then I ended up continued to fight and made it to the Barclays Center, and I fought there last Monday. And a lot of great opportunities God's been blessing me a lot of great opportunities since then, just like being on this show here with you guys.
Oh, awesome.
Great to have you here. And speaking of the Olympics, you actually fought an Olympic alternate.
Yes.
A little bit of a tough competition there. What was that like, knowing that he had that position?
I've always wanted to fight the best. I've always wanted to see who was going to be able to push me to the limit, and who was going to be able to push me to the limit. So coming to the tournament, we were discussing going professional, and I was like, you know what? Hold on, wait. There's a guy out there in my city that they say is the best. We got to go ahead and fight. So I went through the other opponents, very tough guys, got to him. And people, unfortunately, the referees and people, the judges said that he won the fight. But it was a great experience, you know, for one of the top guys in the world. And I just feel like I'm just living my dream, and we're both safe and healthy, and people want to see a rematch, so which we're probably going to do.
Awesome. I like that.
Sounds good. Now, I see you're wearing the silver gloves. They do get silver for second place. So,
yeah.
Okay.
You know, I don't know why Conja didn't bring his gold
not
here.
You know, I knew he was affording it. You know, I didn't want to wear it. I was like, second place is, you know, just the first to lose. I don't want to wear it. But then I thought about it, and like where I came from, you know, a year ago prior, being, you know, sent out of my home and moving somewhere and going and fighting everyone, I was like, you know, I'm proud of it, you know, and as long as the people, you know, were inspired, had a good show, to me, it's more important for me to put in a good performance than to win and put in a boring one, you know? As long as the people that went to go see me on a Monday night when they had work or took off are like, wow, I had a good time, I'm happy, you know?
It took a lot to get there, too, to get second place.
Oh, that's yeah, it
not,
did.
That's not easy. To quote the Cal Norton Jr. from the movie Talladega Nights, ain't nothing wrong with silver. So, but you know, Conja didn't wear his because he thought I was going to rob him. He's like, am I really going to a TV show or does he just want the gold? No. So I get it. It's fine. It's understandable. I'm going to Brooklyn. I'm not, you know, I'm not.
Oh, no.
But we do have the, we have a Conja's fight, actually, you know, his nice championship fight. We have that footage ready. So without further ado, we're going to roll that footage.
Nice.
All right. As you could see, we, you know, same thing as with me. He's outsized, but not outmatched. Mm. And, you know, as I mentioned earlier, some of the other people there just felt that Conja was going to lose just looking at, you know, the massive size difference there.
Oh.
And there's the knockdown. And on the video that I took with my phone, I'm a little screaming in the back, like, oh, you know, you hear that in the background from other people, too. Conja's over there all comfortable on the ropes, confident.
He's ready. Well, look.
I mean, he kind of, I think he knew at that point he was behind in the first two rounds, so maybe he got a little aggressive trying to go for the knockout and then, you know, maybe got a little careless there, but... Very elusive, quick fighter. Mm-hmm. A lot of practice involved to get to that level. You see social media when I posted it, you know, they were like, oh, the other guy was slow and out of shape. I mean, he made it to the finals. It's just, you know, unfortunately, Conja, he's really fast, and he made this guy look bad. He made me look bad, but, you know, it's... Oh. But that's the thing when, you know, like you said, Justin, about fighting the best, you only get better from fighting the best. Like, if you're just used to winning all the time, you see, you know, Ronda Rousey, she loses, and then now she disappears for so long, like, you can't.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I mean, you know, and in any sport, not just in fighting, but, you know, in basketball, you know, playing one-on-one or in the park, you want to play the best competition. If you're going out there just, you know, dominantly winning, you're not really getting much better.
Of course.
You know, you need to be playing against somebody that they can defend you, and, you know, that's the only way you're going to get better in boxing and any sport, really. You got to play against competition.
My little brother says, you know, you live by the fist, you die by the fist. So, you know, you go out there. I thought about a lot of guys I've stopped or knocked out or gunned down, and, you know, eventually it catches up to you if it's old age. But from losing, I've learned so much from losing. If it's not even about something I did, maybe it's about, you know, the people that I have around you. You see a lot, you know. So it's you gotta really look at it and just appreciate even the losses a lot of times.
All right, there you have it, ladies and gentlemen. Now, what's next for you? You said there's a rematch coming, or is that going to be just like a event over the summer or something? Or
they're looking at. Well, I have two rematches, which is really funny. In the Golden Gloves, I had like a stoppage, knockout, 1 minute 27 seconds of the first round, and they called, and they wanted to. The guy wants to fight me again, so I'll give him the rematch, and then the kid I fought on Monday, his trainer said that he's never been hurt like that in like 198 fights, and they like, for international experience, he fights out of the country a lot. They like us to fight again. You know, because it was just such a great event. So I think I'll do those two. And after that, we're looking at professionals. We have a couple of different people we're talking to, you know. So.
What do you think that jump is going to be like? Because we've had, you know, a lot of professional boxers on the show and the program. And they always say, you know, not just the round difference, but, you know, not having the headgear, not, you know, having the refs be extra cautious and, you know,
funny enough, I fought in nationals. I went there with like 22 fights, and it was my first nationals. And we fought without headgear over there, so everybody was afraid of me. Like, oh man, it's your first nationals, no headgear. But I loved it, man. You know, when you hit a guy with no headgear, I'm a pretty cautious fighter. I like to break you, you know, apart, and then usually go for the stoppage or knockout. So without headgear, me being able to hurt people more, and then we're doing more rounds, you know, I think it'll work in my favor better. I like it better.
Because you feel that you've trained for the rounds and...
Yes, of course. When a guy makes a mistake, you know, certain mistakes, I think that even when made a lot of my fights, I hit a guy with a shot, and he might recover because he's wearing headgear. But if he weren't wearing headgear, I feel like the fight would have been over, you know.
What about you, Conja, as far as eventually going to pros? How do you think that would match up?
I actually spar without headgear, so it's like I hate headgear. If I could, I would not wear it at all.
Are me and you having a rematch this summer?
Yeah, we can.
Are you going to put the gold on the line? Or no?
Yeah.
All right, you heard it. That's a binding contract. Put the gold on the line. But definitely a pleasure having you guys. We also want to throw in our blog writer. If you could put up the site up there. We have Eric Sanchez. He's been writing a lot of blogs for us, all different topics, baseball, basketball, everything you could think of. He had a blog recently out there. We also want to get Trip Young back on the set. So if the folks out there, just to show you guys what we're talking about, make sure you check out realfansrealtalk.com. You could go to the blog section. You could scroll down to the bottom. We have a lot of interviews on there. And on the bottom, you have my fight out on there. You got you know, the blogs are on the bottom of the page.
Pictures of me, so you guys could take pictures of me if you want.
Well, I mean, we
of me.
We do have a couple of pictures of you out there. We got you on social media and everything. So, but we're gonna have Eric Sanchez come on the program a little later, and we also have I mentioned at the top of the program, my interview with John Starks, so I know a lot of you folks tuned in for that as well. Of course, New York Knicks legend, known for dunking on Jordan and a lot of other things, three-point shooter, so without further ado, let's play that footage. Nice.
This is John Starks, and you're watching Real Fans, Real Talk.
Real Fans, Real Talk.com. Where Arthur Domus, Trip Young, and intern Tom. For the white and black fans, Asia to Manhattan. I get all my facts from my bro, Mark the Statman.
I personally felt that if Ewing would have made the layup, went to overtime, I think you guys could have beaten that Orlando Magic team. What do you think?
Oh, for sure. Yeah, for sure. You know, we had a lot of confidence. And you know, like I say, it just comes down to really miss or makes in this game right here. People don't understand what it took for Patrick to even play in that game. You know what I mean? He had to get his knee drained the day of the game, and for him to play basically on one leg, you know, I can't say enough about his heart and what he meant to us as our leaders. And so if we could have got to Orlando, I felt like that we would went back to a championship, and that would have been great because we got a chance to face Houston again and redeem ourselves.
All right. Now, one of the reasons why the Orlando Magic got swept that year is because, you know, they were going up against the more experienced team, the Houston Rockets. I feel you guys could have beaten the Magic as well. But do you think rematch Houston Rockets, you would have taken it all the way?
Yeah, we felt like that we were going to beat them this next time around. We had a little bit more incentive, obviously, losing the year before. And so, yeah, we felt like that we had team was a little bit more experienced for the final push. Coming in, still had D Harp, and we had some very solid players on our team. So, yeah, we felt like that if we got back there, I was looking forward to get back there, obviously, to redeem myself during that final, but it just didn't work out.
All right, for those of you who want to know the stats on that hypothetical Magic Knicks, I looked into the archives. You guys actually split the regular season two games and took them to overtime in one of the home games. So for all of you doubters out there, it was definitely a reality that they could have beaten that Magic team. Now you have the dunk. You got a lot of great moments as a Knick. Is there any other moments that aren't as famous as the dunk that, you know, kind of stand out in your Knicks career?
Not really. You know, I'm all about team. Really wasn't about individual. Probably winning the Sixth Man of the Year award just because that year I had to come off the bench because Allen came. That's probably was the most gratifying from an individual standpoint. But, you know, as a team, we accomplished a lot during that era. And we appreciative that we had time to play with one another, and the friendships that we developed during that time still sticks to this day. So, you know, only thing, like I say, well, if I ever had to go back in time and change is that Akeem didn't block that shot and we have a championship. So other than that, yeah.
I would like that to go back in time and change that too. I'm one of the biggest fans of the Knicks, but a well-known Knicks fan, Spike Lee.
Four, five, six.
Is obviously one of the faces of the franchise. What does Spike Lee mean to the Knicks?
It means a lot. You know, he's obviously one of the Knicks' greatest fans and greatest supporters. And, you know, on that sideline when you run out that tunnel, you always see Spike Lee. During my time, he was always there, and he was the inspiration to you know, all the players.
FansRealTalk.com, where Arthur Thomas, Trip Young, and intern Tom. For the white and black fans, Asia to Manhattan. I get all my facts from my bro, Mark the Statsman.
Hello, everyone. Real Fans, Real Talk. We're back. Mark the Statman, Skevich. Trip Young is back in the building. We did a little switcheroo, musical chairs. And, of course, the one and only Ladybug. And for the first time on Real Fans, Real Talk, he's been behind the scenes. I'm sure you've been reading his blogs. Eric Sanchez in the building. Thank you for coming on the program, Eric.
Thanks for having me. I appreciate it.
No problem. You've been talking a lot. You gave your Eastern Conference, Western Conference previews in the NBA.
Mm-hmm.
Your recent blog about baseball kind of covers a few different things. Baseball being viewed as boring, some racial issues with the sport of baseball, and also them not having to go to college like what's mandatory with the NBA and NFL. Can you touch us on what motivated you to write and cover so many details about baseball?
I think overall the game is great, but I also think that it's not promoted the right way. I think a lot of times we see athletes from basketball, football, who are promoted, given the sneaker deals, given the commercials, and there are a lot of great young athletes in Major League Baseball who don't get the same recognition. And so I feel that Major League Baseball is missing out on a great opportunity to target certain athletes and demographics that they're just leaving out right now. And that's really why I wanted to touch on it. And even, as you mentioned, talk about guys having the opportunity to come straight out of high school. In the NBA, you don't get that chance. In the NFL, you don't get that chance. But in Major League Baseball, you can come right out of high school and play without the restrictions and dealing with the NCAA.
Yeah, and you see with LeBron James, even recently, Andrew Wiggins, when they're in high school, you know, there's a lot of promotion about them. You don't really hear about these guys in baseball until it's like right before, you know, like you'll have a free agent. I'm going back to Hideki Arabu, El Duque. You know, they weren't that famous, you know, in America at least until, you know, oh, the Yankees are looking at this prospect, and the next thing you know, everybody knows about them. But you know, they don't really get that publicity, you know, going in. So.
Yeah, absolutely. I think a lot of guys, like you touched on, you got guys like Bryce Harper, Mike Trout, you know, under 25, Carlos Correa, Manny Machado. A lot of people don't know about these guys, and they were all Gatorade athletes, top high school prospects coming out. No one knew about them. So, I mean, that's really what that whole article was about. I think, again, baseball is missing a chance. But, I mean, NFL is still number one here. NBA, we still love it more than baseball. And that's the way it's going to be until they promote the game better.
It's called America's pastime. It was the best in the past. And we see Conja even saying he's not really into baseball. A lot of people perceive it as boring. Trip Young, I know you had some things you wanted to touch on about the blog.
I mean, first of all, no, let me just say this. You know, the blog was definitely a really good one. One thing I do got to say, baseball is boring, man. It's just to that point where it's just like it's too long and it's boring, and that's why people don't want to watch it. You know, especially I know what they're talking about, you know, as far as there's not a lot of minorities, especially at the pitching position in baseball, just in general, you know, as far as African-American minorities anyway. But it's just, I mean, there's too much style going on in basketball. You know, football, you got the physicality of the game. You know, even in boxing, is a lot more swag than in baseball. It's just a slow sport. It's long, and nobody want to sit up there and watch for 9 innings, especially you get a 1-0 game at the end of all of that. You know, the people don't want to watch that, so the kids only going to, you know, they're going to gravitate to what's, quote unquote, the cooler sport, even though you probably make the most money playing baseball if you're actually good at baseball. But it's all about, you know, the fame and right now.
Longer seasons, too, so the money's there. You're playing a lot longer. Yeah. But do you think if they cut down the season or if they cut down from 9 games to 7, because this I'm a Yankee fan, but, I mean, I don't watch every game. That's
it's just too many games to watch.
There are people out there that will literally watch every game from beginning to end. Oh, the game's on. Like, they're playing who? Like, you know, like, and if you want to watch, all right, you know, whatever. Like, but
I think first things first, like Tripp said, watching a game is tough. I love baseball. I grew up watching baseball. But to sit home and watch a 3.5-hour game, that I'm not doing it. I'm not even gonna lie. I love the game. I don't even do it.
Do you think it'll make a difference? What do you think, Tripp?
I don't think it will make that much of a difference because, like I said, as far as like, you know, with the scoring, like it's a slow game. Yeah, it's always fun to see a home run. And I will say this: it's definitely more enjoyable when you're actually at the game because
but
they
even
really
when I'm
get
at
to
the game,
interact.
I'm kind of just talking to people.
Well,
and not really.
Yeah, especially
the
like you know, especially Yankee nowadays, Stadium because it's like an adventure just going to Yankee Stadium because it's so much to do at the stadium. So you kind of don't even really watch the game unless it's like you know Red Sox or something like that or the Mets and whatnot. Not, and then you'll be into the game. But I don't even think going down 7 innings because, like I said, I mean, it's still a slow game. Like, we're not saying it's not going to ever be 25-22. That's not going to be the final score. You know, the 9 out of 10 times is going to be, you know, less than 5 runs. So if you're talking about playing 9
well,
or even
I mean,
7
even,
innings.
I mean, hockey, you have less than 5 goals
but it's a,
usually.
It's a physical,
but
it's a physical
it's a lot
sport,
more
though.
Exciting.
You got the fights in there. Tooth
it's
might fly
really
out, you know, so... You kind of you can get
soccer
into it.
Soccer is a low scoring too, so it's not just
it's,
scoring.
It's, I mean, yeah, it's much more comparable
too, though. So.
Yeah.
Well, except you know, outside of the United States, that's why it's on the bottom as far as the major sports go. All right,
you but if you want to check out the full blog, make sure you check out realfansrealtalk.com. Follow us on social media, Twitter and Instagram at realfantalk. Like us on Facebook, facebook.com/realfansrealtalk. Eric Sanchez got a lot of blogs out there. Make sure you check it out. Final thought, we'll start with our guest, Eric. What do you have to say?
Final thought, I don't agree with Conja. I think Cleveland doesn't make it to the final.
I'm in complete agreement with you.
Put it out there.
You are a Mets fan, but you know, I'm glad that you said something that I could agree with. Ladybug?
Just once again, my condolences out. And big shout outs to my two favorites, Reese and Mercedes, who's always watching. I love you guys.
First of all, shout out to Conja because as a Cavs fan and a Baltimore Ravens fan, brother, anytime you want to come back on the show and sit down, you got a VIP pass. It's all good. You got the Tripp Young seal of approval. So that's first. Second, I'm going to say shout out to the whole cast and crew of Respect Life. The season 2 premiered at 10 o'clock last night. Everybody was calling me to see if I had the secret info for the time, but it definitely aired and the numbers are looking really good. So congratulations to you guys on the second season and rest in peace to Prince, man. I mean, what can we say? That's a legend right there that we lost today. So definitely rest in peace. You know, I got to go back to the old Dave Chappelle with him dunking and coming down slow
game
blouses. Pancakes, right. Anyone?
All right. Well, rest in peace, Chyna and Prince and Rangers, get it together. It's possible in hockey to come back, so let's hope the Rangers do just that. Thank our guests, Justin Biggs, Conja Nathan, Eric Sanchez, thank you all for joining us. And for Ladybug and Tripp Young, I'm Mark the Statman Skevich. Thank you for joining us on Real Fans Real Talk, and we'll see you next week, everyone.
Good night.
Facts, what up, what up? Real fans, realtalk.com. Where Arthur Domus, Tripp Young, and intern Tom. For the white and black fans, Asia to Manhattan. I get all my facts from my bro, Mark the Stats Man. If you're not tuned in, I recommend a CAT scan. And if your brain checks out, then you deserve a backhand. Sports, gossip, all the hot topics. Real fans, realtalk.com. Got it. They got the hottest bloggers.
Did Jeremy Lin hurt?
We'll log on to the site and you can hear it from them first. I'm talking about the latest. I'm talking about the greatest. Yeah. Go check out the archives. Even tell a neighbor. Tell them Bobby sent ya. From spring to winter, tuning in should be the only.